I met Jesus in March of 1953. That's over 64 years ago. Now I'll invite you to Psalms chapter 40, verse 7 and 8. Psalms chapter 40, verse 7 and 8. Then said I, lo, I come. In the volume of the book, it is written of me. I delight to do thy will, O my God. Yea, thy law is within my heart. Now you want to know Jesus? It's in the volume of this book. From Genesis to Revelation, it will tell you about Jesus. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 7. Then said I, lo, I come in the volume of the book. It is written of me to do thy will, O God. So you have it in the Old Testament. You have it in the New Testament. In Hebrews 13:8, Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. No change. In the book of Proverbs, chapter 18 and verse 24. A man that hath friends must show himself friendly, and there is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. That's talking about Jesus Christ. Now, I had 8 brothers. Now, one of them I was closer to than the other 7. But Jesus, closer than that particular brother. 2 Peter 3:18. But grow in grace and in knowledge of our Lord and Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Now notice it says, grow in grace and knowledge. Now you can know some things about Jesus, but you can know a lot more. It's in the volume of the book. It's written of him. Read it, and you'll find out so many things. In John 4:26, this is where Jesus is talking to the Samaritan woman. Verse 25. The woman saith unto him, I know that a Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. When he is come, he will tell us all things. Jesus saith unto her, I that speak unto thee am he. Now the Samaritan woman had come to Jacob's well to get a drink of water. And Jesus is there. And Jesus invites her to give him water to drink. Now the Samaritans and the Jews were like cats and dogs. No getting along. And you, a Jew, ask me, a Samaritan? And Jesus would have just said, now if you knew who I was, you would ask me for water, and the water I give would be like a well of water springing up into everlasting life. And of course, he said to her, I am that Christ, I am that Messiah. And she left her water pot and went back into the city and said to the men, come and see a man that told me all things about myself. I remember visiting in Hazel Park, Michigan with Roy Hummel, and the lady that answered the door said to us, I'm going to hell. I'm divorced, my husband divorced, and we're both going to hell. And I would have said to her the story about the Samaritan woman. I says, Jesus said to her, you've had five husbands and you're living with a man now that's not your husband. And I'll give you everlasting life. And I had said to that woman, have you been listening to some free will Baptist preacher? And she had. And I will just say this to you. Read it in the volume of the book. It will tell you about Jesus. He's the Christ. He's the Messiah. He is the Savior. In John 6:35, Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he that believeth on me shall never thirst. Now when it comes to life, you need bread and you need water. And Jesus says, I am the bread of life. You come to me, you won't hunger, and you won't thirst. Now, I don't know if any of you have ever been to the place where that you didn't have food at the moment and would have been hungry. A few times in my life, I would have been hungry. But I'm still living almost 90 years of age. In the book of Matthew, chapter 4 and in verse 4, Satan has been tempting Jesus, and in verse 4 of Matthew 4, but he answered and said, it is written, men shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Bread alone is not sufficient. The word of God is sufficient, and Jesus is that bread of life. In John 8:23, the Lord Jesus gives us these words. And he said unto them, you are from beneath, I am from above. You are of this world, I am not of this world. In 1 Corinthians 15 and in verse 47, the first man is of the earth, earthy, the second man is the Lord from heaven. Do you know Jesus? In the book of John, chapter 8 and verse 58, Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. Now let's look at Exodus chapter 3 and verse 14. God said unto Moses, I am that I am. And he said, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I am has sent me unto you, the self-existent eternal one. Now, I've always enjoyed reading about Moses and the burning bush. Get your shoes off, Moses. You're on holy ground. And God lets him know that he is the self-existent, eternal one. And you go to the children of Israel and say, we're going to leave. Now, the Pharaoh ain't going to let you go till I put a plague on them, the death of the firstborn. You've got a lot of things to go through first, but you will leave Egypt and you'll leave rich. The Egyptians are going to give you stuff. They want to get rid of you and get you out of there. But I am the self-existent eternal one. John chapter 9 and in verse 5, Jesus says, as long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. Now, we live in a time, and I still don't see why Jesus just don't come on, but our world is sinful and wicked. Now, I have lived in the towers 20 years, 1st of April this year. Very, very, very few people have accepted my invitation to come to Grace Baptist Church. I gave an invitation when I came down the elevator this morning. Now, they don't go to church. And evidently, they don't believe that God is going to punish this world one day, that it's going to burn with fire. I was probably 7, 8 years of age, and there was a lady named Mary Prince. It was spring of the year, and it had been raining for a couple of days, and of course, you know, it's going to rain 40 days, 40 nights, and she's, you don't have to worry about the rain. God is going to burn this earth. And I still remember that. But as long as Jesus is here, he's the light of the world. Now, he's in heaven. Now, you and I that are saved, we're to be the light. We are to reflect the Lord Jesus Christ in our lives, that lost people will see and have a desire to be saved and to live for the Lord Jesus Christ. In John chapter 10 and verse 7, then said Jesus unto them, again, verily, verily, I say unto you that I am the door of the sheep. When my wife Barbara was in hospice down in Palm Bay, a Catholic priest came in, and he said he was a friend of Brother Ron's. And of course, I told him to read his Bible and he'd become a Baptist. He said, no, read your Bible and you'll become a Catholic. And he asked, could he pray? And I said, no. I don't want anyone associated with the mother of harlots praying for me or praying for my wife. And he left. But Jesus is the door. He's the way, not the Catholic priest. Knowing human nature and knowing my own self, we are a sinful, depraved people. Now, even though that we're saved, we have a battle to keep from sinning. The closer you live to Jesus, the less you will sin. The more you live close to him, you'll hate sin. But he is the light of the world. In the book of John, chapter 10 and verse 36, we read these words. Say ye of him whom the Father has sanctified and sent into the world, thou blasphemest, because I said, I am the Son of God. Now, in the 9th chapter of the book of John, the man that had been born blind talking to Jesus. And in verse 35, Jesus heard they cast him out, and when he had found him, he said unto him, Dost thou believe on the Son of God? He answered and said, Who is he, Lord, that I might believe on him? And Jesus said unto him, Thou hast both seen him, and it is he that talketh with thee. And he said, Lord, I believe, and he worshiped him. Do you believe in Jesus? This man that had been born blind had his eyes opened by Jesus, and when they questioned him, he said, I don't know whether you're a sinner or no or not, but this one thing I know, whereas I was blind, I now see. You can know that you're saved, repent of your sins, and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. In John chapter 11, in verse 25, Jesus, talking to Martha, said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? Do you believe it? Jesus asked you the question. Now, people think my wife is dead. Well, she had an eternal life, so how could she be dead? She left her body, but she's with the Lord. Now, coming down the elevator, I'm so sorry that your wife died. And I said, I'm not. She's not in pain or suffering. Now, for the last 2 years, she took 3 or 4 pain pills a day. Now, on a Sunday afternoon, I think it was a week before she went to be with the Lord, she said to me, we have peace with God. We have peace with God. And I am thankful that she could say that, and that I can say that. But I will just say to you that I believe in the resurrection and life of the Lord Jesus Christ, and I'm not going to doubt it. I have eternal life. Now my spirit may leave this body, the body will be dead, but I will not. And Jesus, when he says those words, he that whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die, believest thou this? Now I was saved many years before I came to that truth. My pastors didn't teach it and preach it. But it's there, and I believe it just like that it is, and like Jesus says that it is, the way, the truth, and the life. In John 13:13, Jesus says these words, You call me Master and Lord, and you say well, for so I am. Jesus, Lord and Master. Now, John 14:6 is a verse of scripture that I have known for a long time. And I like the way Jesus puts it. Jesus, talking to Thomas, saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Now, if you read John 6:44, Jesus says, No man can come unto me except the Father which sent me and draw me, and I will raise him up at the last day. You can't come to the Father except by the Son. You can't come to the Son except by the Father. They're working together. I believe it, and I trust, if you're saved, that you really believe it, that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Now, when I think about the word truth, there's probably more lies told today than there's ever been, because there's more sinners in the world to tell them. But the truth you'll find in the volume of the book. It's Jesus Christ. He's the way, the truth, and the life. John 15, the first five verses. He's the true vine. And he says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away, and every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now you're clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine. No more can you, except you abide in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. Now, I would just say to you that the Lord called me to preach in 1955. And I didn't think that I could do it. Of course, when God does something, well, get out of the way and he will help you and permit you. And I would just say that in my ministry, the Lord used me to start four Baptist churches. I never did a day of deputation for any of them. I simply took God and believed by faith that is what he wanted me to do. And of course, now this would be the last church in my ministry, Grace Baptist Church here in Belmont, Florida, that the Lord used me to start. But remember, you can't do anything without Jesus. But when he is with you, you can do anything. When we went to Algonac, Michigan in 1964, I had to borrow $100 from my in-laws to pay for the trailer, mobile home that I had bought in Frankfort, Kentucky to tow it up there. I would just say that on a Sunday, Bob Jones, Bob Carpenter, Demas Brubaker, Ronnie Wolf, sang at Benton Memorial Baptist Church, and we invited him home for dinner. And Ronnie Wolf ran me off the road. It was raining. A man walking toward us, he would have been on the left side of the road coming, you know, me going this way and that way. And Ronnie Wolf started to pass, and he saw him, and he turned the wheel, and I saw him when he turned the wheel. I hit the brakes. The road was wet, and that vehicle just started spinning, and it hit a guard post on the left side of the road. I bounced back, and my youngest daughter, Nancy, had a loose tooth, and after we got back on the road, she said, well, the least it could have done is knock my tooth out. Of course, everybody laughed. Nobody was laughing until then. But that afternoon, I made up my mind the Lord would have me to go to Algonac, Michigan, and wrote a letter to Rhine Road Baptist Church in Warren, Michigan, asking for authority to go there to start the church. And that's how it all began. But without Jesus, I couldn't have done it. But with him, you can do everything. In Revelation chapter 1 and verse 8, and when I think about Revelation, when I went to Algonac, Michigan, I met a man that did Bible, instant Bible index. He not only did the names of the book, but did chapters. He was Church of Christ. And when I went to see him, he would have said, I know the book of Revelation backwards and forwards. And I said, when it says in Revelation, the seventh chapter, about a multitude that no man can number, I said, what about that? And his response, well, some of you Baptists might accidentally get in. But he told me that he didn't know what he was talking about. But in Revelation chapter 1 and in verse 8, Jesus says, I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and end of the Greek alphabet, the beginning and the ending, saith the Lord, which is, which was, and which is to come, the Almighty. Jesus, Alpha and Omega. And Revelation 1:17, John says, when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead, and he laid his right hand up on my saying, fear not, I am the first and the last. I am he that liveth and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen, and have the keys of hell and of death. And then he says to John, write these things which thou hast seen, the things which are, the things which shall be hereafter. And then the mystery of the seven stars which thou sawest in my right hand, and the seven golden candlesticks. The seven stars are the angels or pastors of the seven churches, and the seven candlesticks which thou sawest are the seven churches. Now, I would say to you that the world in which we live in, a big portion of it, believes that the church was started on Peter. And, of course, the Pope, the first pastor and so forth. And then there are those that are daughters of the Roman Catholic Church. You can read it in Revelation 17. But Jesus says there are seven particular churches, the places are listed, and they had pastors. And you don't have one pastor over all the others. You have one pastor per church. Remember, it's written in the volume of the book. In Revelation chapter 5, verse 5 and 6. And one of the elders saith unto me, weep not, behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof. And behold, and I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne and of the four beasts, in the midst of the elders, stood a lamb as it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into all the earth. And he came and took the book out of the right hand of him that sat upon the throne. When I think about Jesus and how much I know about him, as a lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Now, this Bible, and I'm thankful that Jesus has shown me that truth a long time ago, that the Bible makes it plain that God, before the foundation of the world, gave certain unto the Lord Jesus Christ. And Jesus simply says, I give my life for the sheep. Let's go to John chapter 17 and just read a few verses that will verify that truth. John chapter 17, beginning with verse 1. These words spake Jesus, and lifted up his eyes to heaven, and said, Father, the hour is come, glorify thy Son, that thy Son may also glorify thee, as thou hast given him power over all flesh. The Father has given to the Son power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. Now, as many as the Father gave the Son, Jesus said, I give him eternal life. And he does. When you repent of your sins and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, you can have eternal life. In Revelation chapter 22 and verse 16, I, Jesus, have sent mine angel to testify unto you these things in the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David and the bright and morning star. Now, when you think of Jesus as the root, he's the Lord. As the offspring, he's the son of David. And when he was here on earth, he told them, and they couldn't figure out that truth. I didn't figure it out for a while, but Jesus is Lord. And Mary was told plainly that you're going to have a baby. And that baby you're going to have is going to sit on the throne of David forever and forever. Now, I'm looking for the day that Jesus comes back to earth and sets up his kingdom from Jerusalem, and he will rule and reign forever and forever. Now, do you believe in God? In the book of James, chapter 2 and verse 19, says, thou believest there is one God, thou doest well. The devils also believe and tremble. I remember hearing Eugene Clark preach a message. He says, the devils or demons believe more than we do. They believe, but they tremble. Do you believe? Are you trembling? In the book of Matthew, chapter 15, verse 7 through 9, the scripture says, and Jesus talking, you hypocrites, well did Isaiah prophesy of you, saying, this people draweth nigh unto me with their mouth, honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. But in vain they do worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. I believe that we're living in a world that is mostly what's going on. Hypocrites. When you think about a hypocrite and what he says, you don't want to do. In Washington, D.C., I believe there are a lot of hypocrites. They will do just about anything for money. The Senate, the Congress. Now, I don't think we can say about that about our president. I think he's got enough money that he don't worry about it. But they're there not to take care of us and the people of the United States, but they're there to make money for themselves. When they leave office, they all get a big pension. When you think about the presidents that have come still living, they're getting a big pension. They have Secret Service to watch over them as long as they live. But when it comes to a multitude of people, hospitalization, I will say this about myself. I have Health First insurance, and it has been wonderful to me for as long as I've had it. I haven't had a big bill, and I don't know when. The last big bill that I had would have been a $750 bill, and my grandson out in California sent me a check to take care of that. He's a good grandson, Eddie Bowen's son, and but everybody don't have a rich grandson to take care of them. The Bible teaches that, you know, they should if they can. But now, let's get serious. Do you know Jesus? Do you know that as a sinner, you're going to split hell wide open? It's either believe in Jesus Christ and go to heaven, or deny Jesus Christ and go to hell. There's no beating around the bush. Jesus says, I am the Messiah. I'm the bread of life. I'm the water of life. If you're thirsty, come to me and drink. And I will give you water that will be well of water springing up into everlasting life. I have seen a few springs of water in my time. On one occasion, going to Kewaunee, Illinois, their water system, sulfur. But right in the middle of the town, there was a spring. Barbara's uncle says, you want a good drink of water? And he took us down to that spring. And how refreshing. And that's just how refreshing Jesus Christ is. Drink of him, and he'll be a well of water in you, springing up into everlasting life. I'll ask you to stand as Brother Mike comes and leads song of invitation. Sister Wells comes and plays. And if you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ this morning, step out and tell us about it.
Number 465. 465.